I'm Daisy Diggle, your local archaeologist. And welcome for inviting me here. So here I'm going to tell you about an excavation I did on Fogo Island. Fogo Island is one of the corners of the Flat Earth. And I was invited by the Flat Earth Museum of Fogo Island, that's on the eastern coast of Canada, to come and do an excavation by Kay Burns, the director. And this is Brim's Head. That's the corner, actual corner of the Flat Earth. And you can see there's an actual sign, so it's true. And I'm going to tell you about that excavation we did. And the thing was, Kay, she's the director of the Museum of Flat Earth, she found this map. It's an embroidered map of Brim's Head. And the photo you saw just was Brim's Head. This is where the picture was taken. This is the map. And what you see here, very interesting, is an X on the map. So we thought, yay, that's something. And she found that map in the house of the guardian of the Flat Earth corner. And that is a Bartholomew Seeker. And we thought, well, we have to investigate. But of course, Kay Burns is an artist, so she invited her colleague Iris Taylor, who does some more anthropological research. And her company is called I. Taylor Research, so that it's going to become all right. So this is the actual map. If you saw the last picture, you see it fits perfectly. It's like exactly the same. And that's Brim's Head. It's really high, it's a high point. And that's where the X was. So we went and said, ooh, we need to go there and do research. So we applied for a permission to do a mock dig, which is also stated in the application. And the provincial archaeologist signed that we were allowed to do that. So this is an official mock dig. And we had to do that because the mayor was sort of scary that we might dig up some indigenous artifacts. And we were like, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to do the Flat Earth Corner research. And but we had to get permission, so we did. And here you see me, like, going through the landscape with a metal detector, seeing if how the landscape reacts. Well, it was like walking all afternoon. And then suddenly, when we came to where the X was on the map, the machine started beeping. So, bingo. And that was the only location where it beeped. So it's very significant. And this is my colleague, Iris Taylor, who helped me during the dig. She's also known for walks with historic things, and she has done a lot of research on the Flat Earth. And together we also researched in England to see if there's connections with that part of the world. But that's another show. So here you see us actually excavating. We had like a spot for 2 meters by 1 meter. And of course it was in the middle of the summer and it was sunny all week. And then when we excavated, it was like 4 degrees and hell weather. But that didn't deter us. So we had it like officially with the flags and everything. There's no doubt about it, that it was an excavation. And there was a folk festival nearby. And people from the festival were invited to come. So we had like a route set out so they could visit us. Because it was also a public event. And we had museum security because we expected, of course, a lot of important artifacts. Here you see people, and for example, the two over there, they came all day. They were so interested, they kept returning to our site. And it was quite busy. It was good fun. And these are some of the objects we found. You can see this is, to be honest, Brimstone Head. It's a mountain, but what it's really is a volcano tipped on its side. It's a very specific geological circumstance. And we think because of that things fossilize very quickly. And like this spool of yarn, it has become totally bronze. We think that's the geological circumstances. And we're quite sure that we really got the spot of Bartholomew Seeker's research because we found a cube earth. A lot of people think because it's a flat earth, it has to be a pancake. No, it just means that the sides are flat. So, and you can find it out. If you look outside, well, here there's hills, but I come from the Netherlands. If you look outside, it is flat, the earth. It's not hilly. So we're quite sure that this is one of the models he made of how the actual flat earth could look. So, and after we found a lot of stuff, we found, for example, these small boats, clay models of boats, and they were pointing in a direction. So our next research is going to be in the direction of those boats. We found some pottery and tools and also an antenna, because one of Marconi's points, the entrance of Marconi's system for transmitting is on Fogo Island as well, because a lot of people have never heard of Fogo Island, but it's like an important spot in the world. And we found all sorts of things that also point to like transmission and that kind of stuff. So we think he wanted to transmit stuff. And I forgot to tell you, but Bartholomew Seeker disappeared a few years ago in the 70s. And we think that he went to the other side of the corner and has never come back. So it is an exciting story. So this display is in the museum. And of course, because it was an excavation, you also have an excavation report. I mean, you have to have it. So we made like a real excavation with all the things, the drawings, all the descriptions. So if you ever are on Fogo, you can find a description there. So this was all great fun and we had a lot of time. And I think it's time to hand over now to another person. So, some relaxation. Hi, I'm Marjolein Kok. I'm the director of the Museum of Failure and Unloved Objects in Rotterdam. And of course, this was a nice story. Thank you for that, Dr. Diggle, but a professor, I should say, Professor Diggle. But of course, there are some problems with this whole situation. So, this whole excavation was done, as it said in the permit, as a mock excavation. But did the audience really read that? It was about critical thinking. It's about how you get your knowledge. But once you're there, maybe the public has a totally different opinion. What may look unprofessional to us may look authentic to the public. So what the public may say, oh, she's not an archaeologist because she's not wearing guns and a whip. But a pink tool belt is okay for them. So that's all sort of stuff. When I made a picture of the, when the picture was made of the metal detecting, one of a colleague in archaeology said, "Moo, have you ever held that one before?" And I was, "Didn't it look professional?" And he was like, "Mm-mm." And I was like, "Okay, I haven't done it before, but I thought you did something like this." So what looks like a fun and game to us may look very offensive to others. So these are really problems you have to think about. That when you think you're not having any authority because you're wearing pink and you're saying, "I'm your local archaeologist," because it's obviously clear that you're not the local archaeologist. But people may not notice that as much as you may think. So be aware that if you want to be critical, that other people might not think about it as critical. So what you think that may lead to critical thinking may in fact lead to fake news or fake science. And do we really want that in this age? Before I said the thing about vulcanization, well, Fogo is actually a volcano on its side. But the geological processes we invented with that are totally fake. But there were a lot of people who saw the objects and sort of believed us. They were really believing that yarn wool was not an artifact we had made ourselves by pouring bronze into a mold, but that was a natural process. So there's all kinds of things, and we started to realize while we were doing the performance, or while Professor Diggle was doing the performance, that you have to be very careful about what you do. Because you want to make it look authentic by using all your speech and all your knowledge, but it may become too authentic for other people. Because I pointed at a couple that came back all day, and in the beginning they really thought that we were doing official research. And we were, it's in the context of a folk festival. The Flat Earth Museum in Fogo, which actually exists, I must say. It's very clear that it's an art project, and a lot of people who come there also engage with it as an art project. And everybody knows that Bartholomew Seeker is an invented person, because in the museum there's all pictures of it. Everybody takes these steps, but as soon as we came into the archaeological dig, people forgot about that all the other stuff was fake, and they started believing that what we were doing was real archaeology. So the spot we were in, that is now not just like a, well, it looks like nothing, it's like a peaty area. For some people, that is now a historic spot where the excavation was into Bartholomew Seeker's research into the corner of the flat earth. So you have to be very careful about how far you take it, and that you, that people don't take it as literally as you want. Because when you use material objects in your work, things are more convincing and may seem as true. And here is, of course, the deep failure of this project. Because by using the objects, people didn't realize that it might be fake, because objects are real. And what you, as archaeologists, can take away with that is that that failure gives us a very big insight and deeper understanding of what archaeology is really about. Because we are dealing with real objects. And those have a power that go beyond just dating and saying something. They are really engagements with the past. And when we do archaeology, we have to be happy with that. But when we play with archaeology, we have to be very careful with that as well. It can be fun and it can be a failure. So when you do your critical job and your art outside of the gallery box, because that's what we're doing it, be careful. Do you want people to think critically, or do you want to fake them? Thank you.